Hi everyone, welcome to this session on GMAT Score Booster, where I'm going to help you understand how can you actually improve your GMAT score. So if you're really struggling with understanding why your GMAT score is not improving, even after putting in a lot of effort on the preparation, doing everything which is possible in your from your side, this webinar is the right place for you. And before I proceed any further, I would want to know if all of you can hear me loud and clear, if my voice is audible to all of you. It will be great if you can just say a yes in the chat. And please go ahead and feel free to ask me any questions that you have about your GMAT score improvement, like anything that you would want me to cover during the session. Please feel free to go ahead and type in the chat. I will be more than happy to take them up. Obviously, I have my own agenda. I'm going to cover most of the questions which come to students' mind. But if you can add your questions, that way I can take care of anything other than the things which I have actually not covered. I can actually take care of those as well. So I'm not able to see any yeses till now, guys. Okay, so just a quick shout out. If you can hear me loud and clear, if you can just say a yes, that would be great. And please feel free to go ahead and introduce yourself and tell about your current score and your target score as well. In the meantime, I'm going to introduce myself as well very quickly to you. I'm Piyush and I'm going to be your main host in the webinar today. I'm a strategy consultant at GMAT West and I help students improve their scores. Over the last 8 years, I have actually helped a lot of people to kind of understand where they're lacking in terms of their target scores. And I'm have helped them actually get into their dream B schools as well. You name a top tier 1 B school across the globe or even a tier 2 B school across the globe, I'll most likely have a student studying there who have helped get into that school. So that is basically a little about me. I have prepared and taught for both GMAT and CAT myself as a student as well as an expert. And I've scored a 740 on GMAT with a 150 and a 141 and a 99.9 percentile on CAT. So those of you who are from India will probably be aware about CAT. And thank you so much for all of you, Milab, Zakaria, Akash, Ushman, for telling that my voice is audible. I was just making sure that you're audible. I'm audible to all of you. So I've scored 740 myself on the GMAT. And personally, if I ask me, I like analyzing trends. That's my specialty. Like when I take tests, I'm able to understand the strategies which work and which do not work on the test. And I'm able to formulate those strategies better. And with that, we are able to help a lot of students improve their scores in a very, very quick turnaround time. So that is something which we really excel at. Again, this is not just a claim. I'm gonna try and talk about from my personal experience of scoring a 740 and helping students achieve 760, 770s also, that what works on GMAT. And today's session is something very new. Like I've actually come up with a lot of new inferences, a lot of new data, which I'm gonna share with you. And in fact, in the morning, I spent about 4 to 5 hours analyzing a lot of ESRs to share some very interesting data points with you guys today. So let's talk about the structure of the session, okay? So how I have structured the session is, and those of you who watched the teaser for this webinar would have also seen that generally when people struggle, a few of you are saying that, Zakaria is saying, for example, I'm at a 660, I need a 700, and Milab says I'm at a 620. So if you're right now at that score, why is that you are at that score? That, in my opinion, is the biggest reason, biggest problem that people face. People do not understand the root cause. They actually target something else altogether. They do not focus on the root cause of the problem. And in most cases, that is the biggest reason why people take more time than required to ace the GMAT. So that's where we are going to spend a lot of our time, like understanding the root cause. And I'm going to help you figure out from a broader perspective, not just for people who are at a 650 or a 680 or a 700. I'm going to help you understand, even if you're at a 550 right now or a 500 right now, that what could be the root cause behind the problem that you're facing. So that is, in my opinion, the biggest step that you need to take. Once you identify the root cause, the second step is much more easier. But we will then talk about basically creating an action plan that, okay, now that we understand the root cause, basically what is, how can you create an action plan to work on that root cause? Now, before I proceed any further, let me ask you guys. So you guys have already come in this webinar, a lot of, like, I see 30 plus people are already here, but I would want to know from your personal experience, what is that you're doing today to improve your GMAT score? And guys, I want this webinar to be a two-way webinar, not a one-way communication. So please feel free to interact. I love when you guys ask me questions and you post your comments. That excites me to even give the best and add more value to you. So please let me know what is that you are doing right now in order to improve your score. So let me hear your thoughts as well. Let me understand you guys a little better as well. So what is that you're doing right now, or now, not right now, but yeah, nowadays, to improve your score? Or what is the strategy that you have thought of to improve your score? Let's see a few responses. Okay, and I'm going to talk about definitely what many people do. And I, on an average, speak to about 5 to 7 students, and new students I'm talking about on a daily basis. And I'm going to tell you from my experiences, what I hear from students, what they do, and what should be done as well. Okay, Milab says, I'm working on verbal, but really don't really know how to prepare now after the first attempt. Okay, so after the first attempt, you're not really sure how to tweak it further. Don't worry, I'm going to help you with that. So how are you working on verbal, Milab? Usman says, I'm trying to manage my timing, but I struggle to do quant questions in under 2 minutes. So how are you managing your timing? Like, what is that you're doing to improve your timing, Usman? Okay, James says, I'm finishing TTP CR and going through OG questions. So you are practicing questions is what James says. What about others? See, what are you doing? Like, what are you doing to improve your timing? What are you doing to improve your scores? I understand that you're working on your scores, but what are you doing to improve them? What is that thought process? Like, what is the thought process in your mind right now? Okay, Pulkit says, trying to improve my strategy with timing. Okay, good. Okay, Akash says, practicing lots of questions on different concepts. Nice point, Akash. Very common thing which most people do. And honestly, if I actually have to summarize 3 important things most of the students do, number one, practice tons of questions. I've seen people practicing like 2,000 questions, 3,000 questions also. Like, they go and like solve all the books they have, additional questions also. But still, many times, they are not able to improve their score. I'm not saying it doesn't improve your score at all. But if you do not practice questions in the right fashion, if you do not attack the root cause, and just think that, okay, more practice is going to make you perfect. Again, probably that saying, practice makes a man perfect, has to be blamed for this. But practice, just practice does not make a man perfect. Smart practice is something which is very, very important for you to understand. And I'm going to tackle that point. And why practice alone is not going to be sufficient is what I'm going to tell you as well. And a lot of people also focus on taking mocks. That, okay, I did not do well with my timing. If I take more mocks, my timing will suddenly improve. But that is not how your timing improves. Your timing improves by improving the method. That is another thing which many people do. Third thing, which I believe is definitely required, which is concept building, which many people do. But let's understand why practicing questions or taking mocks is not going to be enough. And as I said, we need to understand the root cause. We need to dig into the root cause. And for that, it is very important that we understand how the GMAT really functions. So I'm going to talk about the GMAT algorithm at length now, maybe about next 15-20 minutes. I'm going to bring about a lot of new things about the GMAT algorithm. I take a lot of webinars around this. But today, what I'm going to discuss is a very, very fresh, very new about the algorithm, combined with some things which I generally discuss in my sessions. But there is something new which I have brought. I've tried to simplify the algorithm even further. So let's start with a simple example. So when you basically start the algorithm, like the GMAT test, how it works is you generally start with a medium difficulty question. And I'm taking a very simplified example, guys. Very simple example to help you understand how the algorithm functions. So when you start, you have a medium question to start with. Now, my voice for a second, but I guess now I should be back. So when you start with a medium difficulty question. If you get this question correct, the difficulty level of the next question goes up. So the next question which is given, that question correct as well, the medium hard question correct as well. The next question which is served to you is a hard question. If you get that correct as well, the next one is also hard. Simple terms works. So if you look at the accuracy of the student, his student's accuracy is around 60%. He has got 3 out of 5 questions right. Okay, so accuracy is 60%. If you look at the score, he has scored on a medium question, a medium hard question, and a hard question. So his score is basically. Now let's take another example, another student. This student also starts with a medium difficulty question. But instead of getting the first question right, he gets the first question wrong. Because of which, the next question which is served to him is slightly easier. He gets that wrong. The next question is slightly easier further. So that's an easy question. He gets this question correct. Then he served an easy medium question. He gets that one right. The last question he gets is a medium question. The fifth question, rather, is a medium question. He gets that right as well. Now, calculate the score of the student if you want to, like, very quickly. You will see that the score of the student is basically 6 points. He has gotten a 1 point question, 2 point question, and a 3 point question, right? But his accuracy is same as the previous student. Like, both of them have 60% accuracy. But if you look at the score of these two, this is that many times I have heard students talking about practicing more questions and focusing on accuracy itself. Many people say that, okay, I have gotten an 80% accuracy in the official guide questions when I solve it, but when I take the mocks, my performance in mocks is very poor. And many times, many people are confused why this happens, okay? And some, you might have also heard this or experienced this yourself, that even after having a decent accuracy, your score on GMAT is not that great. Because if you're chasing accuracy as a number, then you're actually chasing the wrong thing. You're chasing the wrong thing, okay? Then that's what I'm trying to prove from this simplified version. 12 points versus 6 points, and both of them have the same accuracy, exactly the same accuracy. Okay, and this is the simplified version. As I said, GMAT does not adapt or change the difficulty level after every question. It most likely changes the difficulty level after a set of 3 or 4 questions. So it's not this harsh, to be honest with you. But yeah, in 3-4 questions, it looks at your performance. If your performance is good, it increases the difficulty level. If it is bad, it decreases it. If it is average, it might decrease it or keep it at the same level. That's how the GMAT works. And we do not know how many points are assigned to each question. We do not even know which is a hard question, which is a medium hard question. That's not written on the question. But what we definitely know is harder questions are valued more than the easier ones. That's how it works. So now with that understanding in mind, let's take an actual scorecard for GMAT. Now I'm moving to the actual scorecard. And please focus on this right now with me. What I'm showing you here is the verbal screenshot of one of our students who scored a verbal 42. Okay. And if you see on your screen, this chart tells us 8% questions correct and 12% incorrect, which basically means he made one mistake in the first quarter, just one mistake in the first quarter, and he got 7 questions correct. Okay. In the second quarter, he made 2 mistakes and he got 5 questions correct. Okay. In the third quarter, he made 1 mistake, so he got 6 questions correct. Okay. And in the last quarter, he made 4 mistakes and he got 4 questions correct. So this is how he performed in the entire test. So total number of mistakes made by, you are not scored on those 6 questions, and the rest 22 questions, like 30 questions are scored. So in those 30 questions, he made 8 mistakes and 22 he got correct. This is basically what the ESR is telling us. Okay. If anyone has any questions in this part of the ESR, feel free to ask me in the chat. I'm more than happy to take that up. Okay. But this is what the ESR is telling you. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring another ESR. So this is the first ESR that we saw just now. 8 mistakes, verbal 42 for the student, and you saw the pattern of the mistakes made by the student. Now I'm showing you another ESR on the right side. Okay, I've hidden the verbal score of the student right now. This student has also made 8 mistakes. Okay, but the pattern is slightly different. 4103. Now I want you guys to tell me, guess the verbal score of the second student which you see on your screen, the right one. The left one we are already aware of. This student has scored a 42 in verbal with 8 mistakes. But what I want you to focus on and tell me and guess is, what is the score, the verbal score of the second student, the one on the right? I'm going to get you this in full screen mode in case you want to look at it. And I'm going to mute myself for like 10, 15 seconds or 20, 30 seconds till the time you guys think about it. So please guess the verbal score of the student and type in the chat, what do you think is the verbal score of the second student? Okay, so I am seeing a few responses now. James says it is 30, should be 38. Jan going for 34. Shubham is also going for 34. Milab is saying 32 to 33, and same is what Zakaria is saying. Pulkit says it should be 37. What about others, guys? And all of the silent spectators just want to see your thoughts, guys. What do you think could be the verbal score of the student? Again, don't worry about whether if you're getting it wrong, but at least if you use your analysis and come up with a guess, then you will be able to understand the analysis which I present to you better. So it always helps to actually solve a question before seeing the solution, right? So it's that way, basically. Okay, Pragya says between 35 and 40. Okay, thank you, Pragya. Akash says 32. Usman says should be 36. Kashyap has gone for the lowest score. He says 28 to 30. Okay, Kabir says 34. Karan says it should be 38. All right, so I see a lot of you talking about high 30s. Some of you talking about mid 30s also, like mid 30s or low 30s as well. But most of you are going for high 30s. Okay, and only one person is saying that it should be between 28 to 30. I have another vote for 37 to 38 from Shunendu, and Sudhanshu says it should be 32-ish. Okay. Pretty close, guys. Some of you are very close. The actual score of the student was a 30. Just a verbal 30. Now try to put this into perspective, guys. Okay. The number of mistakes are exactly the same. Both students have made exactly same number of mistakes over here. Okay. And I'm talking about a drop of 12 points in their verbal score. 12 points in the verbal score. Now, those of you who do not understand the importance of this 12 points, just to give you an idea, if you get a quant 50 and a verbal 42, basically, you get a 760. Now, let's keep the quant score same, okay? Let's say you have a quant 50 still and you have a verbal 30 on the other hand. Then you will basically end up with a score of around 670 only, 670, 660 in that range. So you're looking at the same accuracy, but the overall score could differ by as much as 90 points, which is like a huge, huge difference in the score with exactly same accuracy on the GMAT. And these are actual ESR reports. I've not doctored those reports. I've not played with them. They're exact screenshots from GMAT reports directly. Now, how many of you are thinking that GMAT is really a harsh test? How can this really happen? How many of you are thinking that the GMAT is a harsh test? Why do you decrease the score so much even if the accuracy is same? And trust me, when I was a student, I used to chase accuracy all the time. That what matters is, can I get 80% or 90% of the questions right? Or maybe 70% of the questions right? But that is a very wrong metric if you're looking at GMAT as a test. So if you're thinking that GMAT is a really harsh test, feel free to say a yes or plus one on that. Milab says, I feel that. What about others? Do you feel that as well? Just to show you guys, 8 mistakes. We looked at 2 cases. And just to put the percentiles also into perspective, you'll see the huge difference. There's a huge difference in the percentiles overall. Okay. Not harsh. Usman says not harsh, but quite clever. Jayan says very harsh. Karan says very harsh. Pratyusha says, I also feel that it is harsh. Trust me, I agree with you, Usman. It's not harsh. It's a very, very clever algorithm. It's a very standardized algorithm. It is created to actually judge your skill in real sense. And I'll actually show you that. I don't want you to stop here. I will actually show you that. But just to give you an idea, with 9 mistakes, you can even go down to the level of 21 or even lower. The worst I've seen is 21 with 9 mistakes, honestly. And the accuracy, honestly, is not the right metric to look at if you're looking at GMAT as a test. You will always, always see very different results with very different accuracies. So it's all about relative difficulty. Yes, Zakaria, that's exactly the point. It's all about relative difficulty. So let's now look at the difficulty level chart of these two students side by side. So I've tried to keep them exactly side by side in a similar proportion in front of your screen. Now let's put that simple example that we took into perspective here. So let's try with that. So what happened with this student on the left, basically, who scored a verbal 30, the moment he started the test, he was thrown medium questions, okay? And in those medium questions, if you remember, he made 4 mistakes in this quarter, right? 4 mistakes over here in this quarter. So in the very beginning itself, he did not get the questions correct. He did not get the questions correct consistently. Because of that, the GMAT algorithm decreased the difficulty level. And even in the second, like in the first quarter, throughout his performance was poor. He did not get the questions right. And that's why even in the second quarter, the difficulty level remained at medium itself. Like it did not go up. In fact, it was not even medium. It remained at the same level. On the other hand, this student only made 1 mistake in the first quarter. Okay, one mistake in the first quarter. And that's why you see a significant increase in the difficulty level over here. So if I compare, if you look at the accuracy of both the students, they're very comparable from second quarter onwards. Both of them have done well from the second quarter onwards. Akash says, so first quarter is the most important. Yes, Akash, but it's not completely, like, I won't say that that's the only thing which matters. What also matters is how you perform later, and I'm coming to that as well. But look at this in this fashion, that because of the poor performance in medium questions, and Akash, do not think of it this way, and others also, do not think of it this way, that first quarter is just first quarter. First quarter is a set of medium questions. It is testing your consistency. You need to be very, very consistent with the medium questions. You cannot get them wrong. That is the main thing you have to understand. So if you are practicing and your scores are fluctuating between two tests, especially in the medium and easy questions, that's a very big red signal. You have to, that's an alarm. You have to ensure that your consistency is there in the easy and medium questions, come what may. So because of this dip in the difficulty level, the entire journey was like really, really bad for the student. Now, if you look at the performance, let me take out this like writings from the screen. So if you look at the accuracy or let's say the difficulty level of the questions that the first student got correct in the second quarter, the questions that he got right were mostly easy medium questions. Okay. And on the other hand, the questions that the second student, the one who scored a verbal 42, got correct was medium hard. The average difficulty was medium hard in the second quarter for the student who got a verbal 42. So that is the difference. This is how the algorithm is judging you. You can think that the accuracies are similar, but in reality, if you compare the difficulty level of the questions the two students are getting correct, there's a huge difference in that. There's a huge difference in the performance of the two students over here. And not just the second quarter, guys. Even look at the third quarter. The student is still getting questions which are medium hard questions correct. And this student, on the other hand, is still stuck below the medium difficulty level. And that is the reason why you see such a huge difference in the scores. Now, I'm going to try and help you understand the importance of this. On the GMAT, you're scored on basis of the average difficulty of the questions that you're getting correct. So they look at how many medium questions you're getting right. They look at how many medium hard questions you're getting right. They also look at how many hard questions you're getting right. So that is what they're looking at overall. If you get more easier questions correct, then obviously your score is not going to be that high. But if you get more medium hard questions correct, then your score is going to be high. Now, over here, what I'm trying to do now is, I'm going to give you a perspective into the number of medium hard questions that the second student who scored a verbal 42 has gotten correct. So in the second quarter, he got 5 questions right, and those were of medium hard difficulty level. In the third quarter, he got 6 questions correct. In the last quarter, he got 4 questions correct. So if I look at the number of questions that he got correct, which were slightly more difficult, that is shown on your screen. Now, why did he get this medium hard questions? In the first place, he got those medium hard questions because of his good performance in the very beginning of the test. And over here, the student only got 4 questions correct. So that's why his performance was really bad. Okay, so Chandan has a question. He says, if we hit all 600, 700 level questions and flunk 700 plus level questions, how will that impact the overall score? Chandan, just wait for it. Like, I have a lot of slides on this. So I'm going to share exactly how it will impact if you flunk on the 700 plus level questions. So basically, if you look at this performance of this student over here has gotten 7 medium and 15 medium hard questions correct. Now, again, this is an average difficulty which I'm talking about, guys. When I say medium hard, it could consist of a lot of hard or very hard questions also, some medium questions. But on an average, let's use the definition of medium hard as something which is around a 700 level. Okay, so medium hard is something which is a 700 level question. So this student on the right side, who has scored basically verbal 42, has gotten 7 medium and 15 medium hard questions right. Okay, and I'm just basically doing a sum of these. Okay, sum of this 15 medium hard and 7 medium questions correct. Now let's look at this student on the other hand. This student also got about 22 questions correct. So approximately, again, some of them were easy medium also. So I'm kind of adjusting the difficulty level and telling you approximately this questions would be equivalent to 22 questions that he got correct will be equivalent to 20 medium questions, 90 to 20 medium questions. And that's where the difference in score lies. Is this part clear to all of you guys? Are you able to understand how the score is being calculated? 20 medium questions is fetching him verbal 30. Okay. 7 medium and 15 medium hard questions is fetching the other guy verbal 42. We don't know what is the weightage assigned, but definitely medium hard questions are more valued. So even though both of them have similar accuracy, the reason, the biggest difference is that the second student was able to get medium hard questions correct as well. He showed the capability of getting the medium hard questions right. Is this part clear to all of you? I would like to see a quick yes in the chat. If you can do that, that will be great. I'm just trying to explain this for the very first time, the medium hard concept and the breakdown of the number of questions. I've never tried to explain this in a webinar. This is something which always I understood really well. But I'm just trying to bring out this lesson to all of you. So just want to make sure that all of you are clear with this. And Chandan, then I'm going to cover your question also. That can you flunk the 700 level questions? Okay, Karan says yes. Milab says yes. Pragya also says yes. So glad to see that. I would like to see more yeses if possible. Usman, Chandan. Chandan has a smiley face. So I'm assuming you are clear with this. Yes, can you address Chandan Rai's question about yes, Surendu? Just hold on for a minute. I just want to make sure all of us are on the same page because I'm trying to explain something which is very complex. It took me like 4 or 5 hours to actually identify this pattern, which I'm going to show you next as well. But if this is correct, if you have understood this well, how am I understanding how many medium hard questions this student has gotten right? Then let's move on to the next thing. Okay, so I did this analysis for a lot of ESRs, many ESRs, and I'm actually showing you 4 broad categories over here. Okay, I'm not taking categories which are like around the 20, low 20s. So which categories have I taken? First category, people who score verbal 40 or more. And what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to map the number of medium questions and the number of medium hard questions that they have gotten correct, basically. Okay, so that is what I'm trying to make here. And I'm going to show you the data, and then I'm going to ask you to draw your own inferences. And I'm pretty sure, Chandan, Sunendu, you actually have the answer to the question just by looking at the data. I don't even need to spell that out, honestly. So first score range is verbal 40 or more. We'll see what is the performance of medium and medium hard there. Then we look at the second score range, which is the high 30s, 36 to 39. Then we will look at the third score range, which is mid 30s, like let's say broadly around 32 to 35 in that range. Okay, and last range we will look at is basically the around 30 mark, like 28, 29, 30, 31 in this range. So I've tried to cover the broader segment of people who would be attending this session today. And I'll actually talk about people who are in the low 20s also, but a little later. So let's look at verbal 40 or more. Okay, so this is what I saw. I took an ESR of verbal 42, verbal 41, verbal 40, and multiple ESRs, not just one ESR, multiple ESRs. You try and see the pattern over here, okay, in all these three people. What is the consistency that you see? And please share your thoughts, your inferences in the chat here. That will really, really help other students also. And if you are inferring something incorrectly, I'll be able to point it out as well. So please feel free to share your inferences. So this is the verbal 40 or more category. Let's look at the verbal 36 to 39 category also. Okay. So what you see is the number of medium questions that the student got correct in the second column. Third column is where you see the number of medium hard questions that the student has gotten correct. And in the first column, you see the verbal score of the student. And these are all taken from enhanced score reports, which were in the last 24 months, like most of them in the last 12 months itself. And some of them were in the 12 to 24 month bracket also. And I've tried to take like last 6 months ESRs as much as possible. So that is what I've tried to do, that I keep the data as recent as possible so that you are able to see the current trend, which is how it is working. So any inferences that you guys are able to draw from these two data points? And let me add another data point. What about mid-30s? This is how it happens in the mid-30s. Okay. What about the low 30, around 30s? What happens in around 30 score? If you are scoring around 30, what is happening? Any inference that you guys can draw from this? Any inferences, any thoughts? And I've tried my best to come up with this data because GMAT doesn't provide you this data on the platter. So I've tried to analyze all these CSRs and have used my own calculations to classify something as medium hard because there were questions which were between medium and medium hard. So I looked at the scale, kind of adjusted the scores, so and all of that. So what is the what is the inference that you see? Chandan says, I think I got the answer, right? So Chandan, this is exactly what I wanted to communicate. How about verbal 26? So again, verbal 26 milap will be in similar bucket. I would say number of medium correct will be slightly lower, like lower than 20, and you would have more easy medium questions correct also. Get a significant medium hard right. Okay, great, Karan. Medium hard is a major driver. 700 plus is a major driver is what Kabir says. Accuracy is more in lower level, yet score is low. Okay, yeah, so that is very valid point, Shubham. So if you look at this scorecard, okay, this score range, these people are getting a decent accuracy in medium questions. So if think of it this way, that if you have a capability of getting the medium questions right, but if you do not have the capability of getting the medium hard questions right, you will end up in this bucket, basically. So if you are only getting 650 level questions correct, you will basically get stuck in this bucket. So if you're right now in this bucket, if you're scoring around verbal 30, that's where you're struggling. You're not able to even see medium hard questions. You're not even getting to the medium hard level. You're getting stuck over there. Okay. Now, if you have a decent performance in the medium hard, and this is happening because you have an inconsistent performance in the medium questions. Like out of, let's say 30 questions is served to you, you're getting about 60% accuracy in those. Now, if you have a decent performance in medium questions, as in you have a consistently high performance, let's say 90 to 100% of the questions you are getting correct, then you are exposed to the medium hard questions also. But if you are not getting a significant percentage of the medium hard questions correct, you are going to get stuck in the mid 30s. Similarly, if your performance is really good in the medium questions, you are getting to the medium hard really, really fast, like within the end of the first quarter itself, from second quarter onwards, you're getting to medium hard questions. On an average, I'm saying it could consist of medium from hard also. But on an average, from second quarter onwards, you're able to get to that level. Now, over here, you are performing decently well, I would say. Like in the medium questions, you're getting like 50 to 60% accuracy. The higher it is, the better your score, obviously. But if you are struggling with the accuracy, like not having a very consistent accuracy in medium hard, then you will see yourself stuck in the score range of 36 to 39. On the other hand, if you have a very high accuracy on medium questions, from the first quarter itself, second quarter itself, you are able to get to the hard level. And then also, you have a significantly high accuracy, let's say about 70 to 80% in hard questions, that's when you see scores like this. And these are scores which will take you to 760, 750, and 740 respectively, obviously with the quant 50 I'm saying. Okay, so this is how you read the data, and I'm so glad that you guys were, all of you were able to draw the inferences from it. I was not really sure if I should present this complex data to all of you, because this is a lot of complexity in this, a lot of moving events in this. So I've tried to make it as simple as possible for you. Okay, Shubhanandu says the baseline number of medium correct sets a minimum bar, it seems, then getting more medium hard correct pushes the score up. Very good point, very valid point, Shubhanandu. It's basically about making sure that you are consistent. In simple word, one simple word if you have to put it, if you have to do well on the GMAT, you have to get consistently good, deliver consistently good performance. If you're able to deliver that performance in medium questions, then you basically get to mid-30s and above. Basically, and if you are able to deliver that also in the harder questions, you get to the verbal 40 or more. Okay, so if you do not have high accuracy in mid level, we won't get the medium high questions exactly, and we will get stuck there exactly. You will get stuck around the verbal 30. So now let's look at it from the other way. Okay, like we looked at data, we looked at all this, but let's understand, let's draw inferences from this. So what is happening if you are in the score range? So if you are in the score range of verbal 40 or more, if you are in the score range, probably I don't think many of you will be there, because I am assuming that most of you who are here are looking for improvement. So if you are in the score range, it means you are even consistent with hard questions. As in hard questions also, or medium hard questions, what do you call it, your accuracy is about 70% or more. So you're pretty consistent with them. Okay, that is something which is very important. Now, what happens? What does verbal 36-39 mean? And this is all about improvement, guys. So as I said, the entire discussion that I'm having right now is to help you understand that what is the root cause of your issue. So try to see what your mock scores are at present and try to map them to this scores that you see on your screen. So if you are, let's say, in the 36 to 39 range, That basically means you are having inconsistency in hard questions. So you're good. I'm not saying you're bad. You're pretty good in hard questions. It's just that you're a little inconsistent. You need probably a little more focus on the slightly harder questions. You need to get them more consistently correct. So people in this score range would be the ones who are in the low 700s or just, let's say, inching towards 700, 690, 680 typically. So if that is the case with you, you need to fine tune your methods a little. And I'll come to this more in depth as I move forward. Now, what if you are in the third score range? If you are in the third score range, which is in the verbal 30s, again, per my analysis, please don't mind this when I'm saying this. Per my analysis, what I feel is that you are just getting lucky with hard questions. Okay, it's not like you have the right skills to get them correct consistently, but you're also getting lucky. Like, it's like you're always confused, 50-50 chance, you're stuck between two choices maybe, or you're always confused whether you're marking the right answer or not. The confidence is not there. So in such cases, your methodology that you're following to solve questions need to change completely. Complete overhaul is needed. And I'll talk about this a little more as well. Now, what about the case when you're actually around the verbal 30 only? If you're around the verbal 30 only, that basically means you're inconsistent in medium questions also. So even in the medium questions, you're struggling. Okay. So in simple words, if I have to put it, in order to do well on GMAT, I'm just summarizing whatever we discussed. In order to do well on GMAT, you cannot rely on accuracy. You have to rely on skill building. And skill basically means the capability of getting medium and hard questions correct consistently. The key word here is consistently, guys. Focus on that. Okay. Akash says, I have a question here. So medium hard questions drive the performance. What if I'm getting medium hard questions correct and suddenly test shoots an easy question? How can it differentiate the scoring? So Akash, that generally will not happen. If you're at a medium hard level, the score will be at medium hard level itself. You will only get medium hard questions. That's how the adaptive algorithm is structured. If you get an easy question, that will most likely be an experimental question. Okay, so don't worry about that. And experimental questions are not scored. What happens if we get only SC hard questions correct and not in CR and RC? Will that affect the score drastically? Yes, Sudhanshu. So if you look at this performance, which I shared with you, this is across all three areas, right? If you're just getting questions from SC correct, you will not be able to get 15 questions right. You will most likely be stuck in this range. In fact, that is what happens. If you are only good in one out of the three areas of verbal, SC, CR and RC, you will most likely, and very good, I'm not saying just good, very good, as you said, then you will be stuck in the mid 30s only, 34, 33, 35, in that range only, or in the low around 30 range. And that is what the case is. If you are in that range, you will be able to see, you will be actually getting the similar score in the mocks also. Okay. So skill over accuracy is what you need to focus on. So in simplest possible way, if you want to get a high 700, first thing you need to do is make the algorithm serve you hard questions. So in order to do that, you need to have a very high accuracy, easy to medium questions, about 90 to 100%. There's no tolerance over here, no tolerance at all. And then once you get the hard questions, you need to get them correct. And for this, you need to learn the right skills. Guys, this is very important. Understand it this way. What differentiates an easy question from a medium question from a hard question? And all these differences, basically. If you look at the difference, basically, over here, in easy question, it is directly based on concept, and it's mostly one concept which is applied in the easy question, just one concept. On the other hand, in medium questions, there would be a combination of two or more concepts, but it is still directly based on concepts itself. If you can just do a little bit of methodology, follow a little bit of methodology, you can get those right. Two or more concepts, not more than three generally, but it's very rarely there. But it is generally more than one concept which is applied in a medium question. Multiple concepts are applied in a medium question. In hard questions, there are three or more concepts which are applied, and it is not easy to identify which concept is to be applied. For example, let's take an example of sentence correction. If it's an easy SC question, you'll be able to look at the option choices and even understand that, okay, I have to focus on the tense or I have to focus on the pronoun. In a medium question also, you'll be able to identify two or three areas where you need to focus on. But in a hard question, which rule is to be applied itself is going to be very difficult to figure out. So that's the differentiation between all three question types. So in order to tackle the medium question, easy question, if you're conceptually sound, it works. In medium question also, you can work to a great extent. But to get the hard questions right, you need to build the right understanding of approach, the right method. If you're using shortcuts, they will not work for hard questions. You need to have logical and consistent methods to identify what is supposed to be applied in hard questions. So if you are getting the score range of 550 or less, again, this is something which I did not cover till now, it generally means you're even not getting the easy questions right. You're not even seeing medium questions at all. So you're struggling with concepts. So for those, I would recommend doing a complete overhaul of the prep, starting with the basic concepts itself. Let's focus on the other areas as well. So one range which I'm going to talk about, start with, is people who are in this score range, 670 plus overall, or verbal 36 plus, or quant 47 plus. If you are in this bracket, it basically means that you need to fine tune your methods. The methods which you are probably using right now, in general, are good. Probably it's possible that in specific modules, you are not using the right methodology. So it's possible that your methodology for CR, or let's say RC for that matter, could be poor. And I'll take some case studies as well as we move forward. I'll take some case studies of our students who we have worked with at GMAT West and how we help them identify which specific modules they are weak at. In fact, we had a very recent discussion with Shreyash. Those of you who attended his actually interview last week would have actually seen that. But in case you want to watch his video recording for the interview right now, you can actually watch it using this link. I've just shared it in the chat. So this guy came to us at a verbal 35. His approach basically needed to be tweaked primarily for sentence correction and RC. So if you are in this score range right now, you need to improve your approach on specific modules. That is most likely the case. So fine-tuning the methods is required, and you need to maintain the consistency in hard questions. In fact, Shreyash was able to improve his score to a 760 by focusing on the specific modules. And I'll talk a little more about those case studies as well. But overall, this is the problem. Okay, Aditya has a question. If we keep getting hard questions correct consistently, will we get hard questions in fourth quarter too? Yes, Aditya, you will definitely get hard questions in fourth quarter as well. That's how the algorithm functions. Now let's look at the second case, okay? The second use case. Now, what if you are in the score range 600 to 670, or let's say verbal 30 to 36 in that range, or quant 42 to 46 in that range. If you are at, it basically means there are few concept gaps. Again, trust me guys, I actually speak to many people, and many times people come to me who have scored a 640 or 620 on the GMAT, and they have prepared for like 1 or 2 years, or maybe sometimes 2 months or 3 months, depends, but they are really frustrated. They are not able to get the score. And I understand the frustration. I was also there, stuck in that score at a point of time. But many times the students tell me that I don't have any concept gaps at all. I only need to practice more questions and I can get my scores up. Which many of you are also saying, that I just need to practice more difficult questions. But trust me guys, if you are in this score range, practicing alone is not the best thing for you. There are some concept gaps. I'm not saying many. Few, but you definitely need to work on them, because those are the low-hanging fruits. This is where your accuracy in the medium questions is also struggling a little. So this is why I'm saying that concept gaps also need to be worked upon a little. Second thing, if you are in this score range, you most likely need to completely overhaul your methods. And this is from my personal experience that I have seen. I've worked with many students in the past, many students, thousands of students that you can think of. And when people come with this scoring, generally the methods that they're using are really flawed, or they're like shortcut focused. So you need to change your methodologies. And when we even do private tutoring with our students, and like our private tutoring is really, really successful, this is what we focus on in this case, like how to change your methodology altogether, how to focus on improving your methods altogether. So you need to focus on improving the methods, and then focused practice will work for you. Right away, directly, you should not be doing focused practice. That's not the right thing for you. Now, what about the last range? In case you are in the 550 to 600 range broadly, or in the verbal 26 to 30, or 37 to 41 in quant, it generally means you have multiple concept gaps. Okay, and please do not take this for granted, guys. I see many people thinking, okay, I am in the verbal 27, 28 range. I know all the concepts. Let me not worry about the concepts. Let's just practice questions. Don't do that, guys. There are definitely multiple concept gaps which exist. I'm talking from experience. And you also need to do complete overall of the methods that are using, that you're using. And you should do this by focusing on application-focused learning. And this is something which is very, very critical, guys. I'll talk about it a little more as we move forward. Application-focused learning is very important. The traditional way of learning for students is they learn concepts, they learn few areas, and then they just move to practicing questions. when they are learning concepts, they do not really focus a lot on the application part of it. They do not think about how to apply that thought process over there. Okay, so this is something which is important. So what I've tried doing is tried helping you understand that practicing questions alone will not suffice unless you tackle the root cause. So read this chart, identify the root cause that you are facing right now. That is very critical for you. So I've tried my best, guys, to kind of divide the categories into multiple areas. But still, we feel that always people are different. Everyone is different. Generally, when I speak to students, I take into account multiple factors when I actually tell them how to create an action plan or how to where your root cause, your problems lie. So I look at the time available. I look at their target score. I look at the kind of material that they have used till date. I look at the strengths and weaknesses that they have. And we also try to understand the methods that they use and the learning style that we have. So through this, all this understanding, once we are able to understand this, we are able to give you a very pinpoint feedback in terms of how can you improve your score. So in case you are interested in connecting with me or GMAT as experts to understand how we can help you improve your scores, how we can work together, identify your weak areas and get your scores up, then you can schedule a discussion with us using this thing. This is the discussion, like you can schedule this discussion for free. We don't charge you anything for this, but we will try and understand your weak areas and exactly where you're suffering, and we will definitely try to help you. So if you want to improve your scores, you can definitely reach out to us as well, to the broader team. I've just shared the link in the chat. You can use this link to schedule a discussion with us. But what I've tried doing earlier was to broadly classify all the categories which are there. In case you need personalized advice, you can connect with us. Okay. Now let's talk about the approach part. So I have been talking about the method from a long time now. So I want to touch upon the approach part a little. And to help you understand this, I'm going to take up an example. From reading comprehension. I could have taken up RC or SC or even quant for that matter, but I'm just taking one example, reading comprehension itself. So what are the common problems that people face in reading comprehension? And let me ask you guys, what are the common issues that you are facing right now in reading comprehension questions? Let me see some of your responses in the chat. Can you guys tell me what are the common problems that you face in reading comprehension? And in fact, from my ESR analysis, I have actually learned a lot about the GMAT algorithm. I wanted to talk about a few more things, but then I felt that it will be very verbal focused then. So I am not bringing those data points. But just to tell you, out of all three areas in verbal, RC and SC are the most important. CR is the least important. This is basically what I've seen as per the data which I have seen for the ESRs. So RC is in fact the most important because the questions are consecutive. So what is the problem that you face? Okay, so Dipti Ranjan says, I face the problem with literature passages. Mudgala says, Akshay basically says, the vocabulary is an issue. Sunendu says, very long passages. Difficulty in interpreting the passages, what Karan faces. What about others? Inferences is what Usman is struggling with. Okay. What are the other issues that you guys face? I'm unable to understand the literature passages because I'm from tech background. Dipti Ranjan, exactly, this is how I used to think also. In fact, Akshay, when I actually started preparing RC, I memorized like 2,000 words, basically. 2,000 words in 2 months, thinking that it's all about vocab, but it was not, trust me. And it is not about being from the same background. It is more about making sure that you're interested in the passage. Zakaria says detailed questions. Sai Prasad says it is the inference. Okay. Main problem I face is exhaustion due to SC and CR being small and RC being too much to read. Okay, that's an interesting point. Subham says I come down to two answers and select wrong answer due to overthinking. Okay. So the main problem which many people face is they are confused about the meaning. They do not know what they have read. They do not even have a very clear understanding of the context. When you read a passage, it happens many times that you just have a rough idea of what was there. You know the main, like a few things which were there in the passage, or you're too much into the detail part. You're not able to identify the main idea, which Saugato is saying, that the face problem with main idea or central idea. Okay. Another problem is that people need to refer back to the passage multiple times. You end up consuming a lot of time. And when you are marking answers, you're still not confident even after putting in so much time. Now, these are the common problems which I also faced when I was a student and I was learning RC for the very first time. But if I look at the main reason why this was happening, main reason why I was struggling in all this, the main reason was how I was approaching RC. In the very beginning, when I started approaching RC, my focus was on improving my reading speed. In fact, I used to have this ordeal of like half an hour every day with my breakfast, I will read editorial section of newspapers. And trust me, can anyone guess like what used to be my focus when I was reading like that newspaper for 30 minutes? What was my focus when I was reading the newspaper for 30 minutes? That editorial section. And I used to have a physical newspaper, Hindu or maybe Statesman. That was basically, I was in Calcutta. So we used to have Statesman over there, which was a very good newspaper, basically. So what used to be my focus? Can anyone tell me that in the chat? I know it's a difficult question probably for you to answer, but can you guess, guys, what used to be my focus? Okay. And if I don't get the answer in like 10 seconds, okay, time, word and vocab. Subject, verb, Akshay says, okay. Adhiraj, you are right. It was time. I used to time myself saying, okay, in 30 minutes, how much of this page can I read? That was my entire focus. Not understanding everything, Shubham. I used to focus on reading fast. Obviously, I did not just read quickly. I was also trying to understand a little, but my focus was not on too much of understanding, but main on reading and remembering which part was where. So that is how I used to do it. And that was a foolish step. Trust me, it was a foolish step, because in GMAT RC, your reading speed does not matter. What matters more is the comprehension speed. How quickly can you comprehend? And in order to comprehend better, you need to read slow. So it was actually counterproductive. Yes, Anuj, exactly. I used to focus on reading max in less time. So the reason why I did that was because when I was a student, my tutors, when I was learning, basically, they used to teach me certain methods overall, which were not really very well aligned with the GMAT itself. So the first approach that I learned for RC was that read the first line and the last line of every paragraph and jump to the questions, basically. That was the idea that I thought. That, okay, let's read the first and last line. Teachers used to teach me that, okay, read the first and last line, understand what the para is about, then jump to the questions, and from the questions, see where, which part of the passage is the question related to, and then only attack that part. Why read the entire passage? I focused on this approach to start with. That was approach one for me. The second approach, which I tried, and this is the approach that I stuck to for a long time, I guess about 70 to 80% of my prep, I stuck to this approach, which was to read the passage really quickly in 2 minutes and then take a mental note of what lies where and then refer back to the passage. So instead of just reading the first line and last line, I would read everything, but quickly, just to see like a map, basically, what is where, and then come back to the passage. And third approach, which I got exposed to, but I did not like it, so I did not focus on it, but many students still follow it, is read the questions them first, so you know what you're looking for, and then read the passage. That's what many people do. But none of these approaches will work. And why am I talking about all this, guys? You need to understand the context behind it. I help you understand that if you want to get the medium hard questions correct or hard questions correct, you need to improve your approach. And if you're following the wrong approach, doesn't matter how many questions you practice. The more you practice, the better you get at using the wrong method. But you will still not get the optimal outcome or the most effective outcome. Because if you do not change your reading style, if you do not change your methodology, you're not going to see that improvement happening. Okay, Nandini, if my screen is blurred, try to change the settings in your side to the video settings and keep it to HD, 720p or 1080p. Probably it's because of that. My internet speed should be fine, I guess. I don't think it should be blur for everyone else. So this is what you need to do. You need to change your approach. And why am I saying so? Understand the root cause behind it. In GMAT and RC, 85% of the questions are inferential in nature. Either they are directly based on inference or main point or function or structure or application. For example, the question stems will read like this. Which of the following is the author most likely to agree with? What is the function of the word Renaissance? Which of the following is against the author's opinion? And all these questions require you to read between the lines. So if you're not reading between the lines, if you're not reading properly, you will definitely face issues in RC questions. So in RC, it is very critical that you focus on involved and evolved reading. You need to understand each part of the passage in the lines. And if you do not do that, you will get stuck with the harder questions. And not just RC, I'm just showing you the approach, the best method, which works for all the users on GMAT, basically. If you're focusing on SC, then your approach should be meaning focused. Many people who are like non-natives, they focus on a more grammar heavy approach. And even some of the most popular courses also talk about grammar heavy approach. But grammar heavy approach will not really work well on the 700 level questions, the harder questions. So you need to focus on the meaning-based approach. In CR, you need to do free thinking, pre-thinking. In DS, you need to do drawing inferences before going to statement one or statement two, and so on. And all these approaches are central in GMAT Viz. When we created our coursework, we wanted people to get to that level, and we dissected the problem. We understood that the main issue is people do not follow the application-driven thought process from the very beginning. And that's why in our course, we will teach you all these methods. In fact, every single question which is there on our GMAT Viz portal, those of you who are GMAT Viz students will definitely would have seen this, but any single question which is on the GMAT Viz portal will basically follow, give you the solutions using this methodology consistently from the get-go itself till the last day. So basically, this is something which you can learn. Now, I'm going to focus a little on the meaning-based approach part. Now, how do you develop this meaning-based thought process? So I'm going to just help you understand. Take this as an example. In case you are learning, take this as an example to help you learn. But it's true for everything else. For meaning-based approach, I'm going to show you how you should start your learning. So imagine it this way, that meaning basically is the central thread that combines all the grammar rules when it comes to sentence selection. Many people, when they prepare for SE, they find that they are able to solve questions when they are learning that topic. For example, you have learned tenses right now. So you will be able to solve questions on tenses correctly because you have just read it. So the questions that you are solving, you know that you are looking for the tense error. You are able to apply the concept and get it right. But when you solve directly questions at the end of the entire exercise, or maybe 700 level questions, where you don't know which error you are looking for, many people face problems with that. And over here, meaning will come into picture. So if you, instead of learning these rules from a grammar perspective, try to understand the logical aspect of all these rules, then you will be able to basically solve all the questions properly. So meaning is the common thread that binds them all these concepts which are tested on sentence correction. So when you start sentence correction, when you start learning sentence correction, your first learning step should not be to learn rules. Your first learning step should be to learn how to identify the intended meaning of any given sentence, how to understand the intended meaning. And trust me, guys, if you're attending my webinar, I know that you can speak English well, you can understand English well. I'm not questioning your skill at all, okay? I'm also a non-native speaker, but I have learned English as my first language. But the language which is tested on GMAT verbal, GMAT sentence correction, is complex. Even if you are a non-native speaker who has had English as the first language, you will still struggle to understand the meaning completely. You will get 70% of the meaning. But to get the 100% of the meaning, you need to actually develop that skill properly. It is not close to what native speakers can do. So the first thing that you need to start with is understanding the meaning of any sentence. And if you use GMAT Viz course, again, this is just a snapshot of our course, but I'm just showing you this to you to understand how the learning curve should be. We spend about 8 hours, approximately 7 to 8 hours, to help you understand the intended meaning properly. And what we do is we help you how a sentence is constructed, created basically, then how to pause at relevant points, what kind of questions you need to ask. And all this consists of a lot of quizzes as well. So there are lessons to learn, there are quizzes to practice to ensure that you are actually thinking about the meaning properly. And in this, we will not do all these things from a logical aspect, that how a sentence is constructed, where do you pause? What kind of questions do you ask to understand the meaning properly? And then we go to individual topics. Then we go to individual areas where you have the intended meaning, like of each topic being taught to you. Subject, verb, pair, noun, pronoun, pair, modifiers. We teach you all these grammar rules from a meaning perspective. So our idea is simple. If you know how to identify the meaning of any sentence, and then you know the grammar rules also from a meaning standpoint, you can identify the errors for any given sentence properly. So that is what we do. In each of these exercises, you have multiple quizzes to solve, multiple things to do. So in simple terms, if you are using GMAT Viz, this will be very easy for you. If you are not using GMAT Viz, even then, when you are improving your SE skills, first thing you need to do is understand the intended meaning of the sentence properly, and then learn all the grammar rules from that perspective. So this is just to give you an idea about that. In case you want to check out a free trial of the GMAT Viz portal, there is a free trial which is available. You can check that out as well. If you find it useful, you can always use it to your advantage. Now I have a question, a couple of questions from people. So Saugata says, pre-thinking, can you please summarize that approach? So pre-thinking, Saugata, again, you can check out some of our webinar recordings. We do a lot of webinars on pre-thinking as well on GMATWiz YouTube channel. Pre-thinking is mostly about having an understanding of the context and on which lines can your answer be. You don't have to exactly think the answer. You just have to identify the flaws in the argument. Usman says, do native speakers have an unfair advantage? If you ask me, Usman, definitely there is a little bit of it, but thankfully on GMAT, all the things which are tested are logical in verbal also. In GRE, the questions are more vocab focused. So there, natives have a lot more unfair advantage over non-natives. But since in GMAT, they are more logical in nature, if you think from approach things from a logical perspective, you'll be able to do well. In fact, you will find a lot of non-native speakers doing well on verbal. Obviously, native speakers will have that edge that they will not have to think about meaning or prepare for meaning. They can just look at the grammar. So you'll have to put in extra effort, but it is definitely possible to get a good score. Okay, so this is basically how you improve. Now I'm just taking a few case studies to help you understand how other people have done this in the past. So till now, what we have done is we have tried to understand that in order to get your high score, you need to identify the root cause. Try to categorize your problems into various buckets that, okay, if you are in this score range, this is the area that you are faltering at, and this is how you improve on it. Now what I'm showing you is I'm showing you some examples where people have done this in the past strategically, and I'm going to show you some examples to understand how you can also do it strategically yourself, okay? And from there, we will then move to the action plan. So in another 10 minutes, I'll start talking about the action plan that you should create in order to basically get a high score on GMAT, okay? But let's look at some case studies. So this is first case study which I want to talk about, Akshar, who actually improved from a 650 to 730 in just 24 days. Now, how did he do this? First thing, he identified the root cause. He saw that in verbal, he is actually not having any problems with sentence correction. In 87th percentile basically means he is getting the medium hard questions correct in sentence correction as well. But where he is really struggling is CR and RC. Second thing which he saw was his timing was poor under anxiety. It generally takes a lot of time in the beginning, because of which his score struggles. In fact, if you look at his performance, in the beginning he was able to do well, but then he was under time pressure because of anxiety also. So he had to work on anxiety and the weak areas in verbal. So what he did was he started focusing on the weak areas alone. In the next attempt, he focused only on the CR and RC part. And what you see over here is a jump in the performance in RC as well as CR both. And he kept his SC at the same level. So obviously he was in touch with SC, did not take it for granted. But he worked on CR and RC a lot. How did he work on those? So what he did was, first thing, he knew that he is not able to get the medium and medium hard questions correct. That means he needs to improve his understanding of the methodologies, the approach. He did not just randomly practice question. So he improved his understanding by going through the framework-driven pre-thinking in CR, which we teach at GMATWiz. So he learned that method, and then he reviewed the solutions in depth for the correct answers too. So understand it this way. Just by knowing the method, just by telling you, hearing that, okay, meaning-based approach is what you should follow in SC, doesn't mean that you are able to apply that on every question. It is very important that you review the solutions in depth properly for the question that you are solving to match your line of reasoning with the solution, which should be providing you the meaning in depth. Similarly, if you're using framework-driven pre-thinking, for example, you need to have access to a solution where the framework-driven pre-thinking is detailed out. So Saugata, the question that you were asking, so if you need to learn pre-thinking, you need to have solutions which is detailing out that thought process. So when you have that solution, what you can do is, after solving the question, you can map your line of reasoning line by line. That, okay, did I actually think of it in this fashion? Was I actually on the right track from the get-go, or was I not? So that way you'll be understanding where exactly you're going wrong with respect to the approach also. Okay. And what he also did was, when he was attempting the questions, when he was solving the questions for the incorrect answers, he used to identify the reason why he thinks it is incorrect. He did not just eliminate the answer randomly. He focused on identifying the exact reason why that answer was incorrect. And then he used to, when he was used to review the solutions, he used to tally that with the solution. That is it this distortion? Is it out of scope? Is it irrelevant? Is it opposite? Now, these are certain terms which we use in GMAT Viz. We tell you what is distortion, what is out of scope, how to eliminate answer choices on solid grounds and all of that. So he eliminated the answer choices on solid grounds and used to verify that with the solution. And then he also worked on weak areas, the low-hanging fruits, to improve his understanding. So that's how he was able to improve the score by 80 points in just 24 days by focusing on the approach, fine-tuning for the respective modules. In case you want to check out Akshay's interview, again, I've just given you a brief overview of it. In case you want to check out his interview, you can use this link to check it out in detail. We have discussed with him from his learnings. And not just Akshay, even Shreyas, this guy we interviewed very recently, last week itself on Monday, where we talked about his journey from a 640 to 760 on GMAT overall. And he also focused on the similar thing, that in the 640 attempt, he looked at his verbal performance and the quant performance, what were his weak areas. And within 2 months, he was able to improve to 760 with this course. So guys, it is definitely possible for you to improve your scores if you really want to. So let's get to the solution now. How do you work on this? So you have already talked about a lot of things around the main areas, main problem areas, but let's think about the planning part now. How do you plan your improvement? So first thing which I want to talk about is the planning stage. How do you plan your improvement? And then we will talk about, like, first thing is to plan it right, create an action plan, and then you will start execution. So these two phases are about execution. Okay, so let's talk about planning. How do you plan things? Okay, now again, I'm trying to do my best to actually take up different use cases to help you guys understand how to work on it. But in case you guys want to connect with me personally to discuss how you can actually improve, how you can create a plan of action, please feel free to do so. I'll try my best to actually make it as objective as possible overall for all the users. But again, every student is still different. So there's a chance that there might be a little bit tweaking which is required. Okay, so I'll take up Chandan and Saugata, your questions also, but let me take up in 1 or 2 minutes. So in order to plan your studies right, your plan of improvement right, you need to focus on one section at a time. Okay, do not work on both quant and verbal unless you have more than 20 hours in a week to study. So focus on one section at a time, improve it properly. And if you're a retaker, then focusing on the weak section will make more sense. Okay, so that is something which is important. Okay, so Saugata's question is very relevant. Let me take it up. Will we have the time in the main exam to evaluate why an answer is wrong? Saugata, you honestly speaking, if you do not evaluate why an answer is wrong, how will you know whether it is a wrong answer? You need to know, right, why an answer is wrong. And it is not like you have to do it consciously every time to classify it into distortion or out of scope. What I'm saying is that Akshay did this in practice very regularly. He started doing that consciously. And when you do something consciously, that starts happening subconsciously automatically when you do it for like 15, 20 days. Trust me, that is something which will automatically happen. When I am able to solve a question, I know why an answer is wrong. I'm marking something as wrong. I need to have a proper reason, right, why it is wrong. And you can actually classify that into bucket. On the day of the test, is it required? Definitely no. You do not need to tag that, okay, this is irrelevant, this is out of scope. But if you do it in your learning phase, that increases your chances of eliminating each choice on the strong ground. You're not just randomly marking that. So I would definitely recommend you to do that in the learning phase. Chandan has a question. For practicing verbal questions, what should be the sources? I feel official questions are too less to have a comprehensive practice. So Chandan, if you're looking at practicing, again, first of all, focus on the approach. If your approach is right, then only focus on practicing. Now, for practicing verbal questions, if you want, you can look at quality questions will be there from Manhattan, Veritas, GMAT Viz also. One benefit of GMAT Viz will be that you will find the solutions in line with the methodologies also. You will get detailed solutions, not just that, okay, this answer is right and this answer is wrong and why is that right and why is that wrong. We detail out the entire thought process from scratch till end. So that is something you'll find very helpful. So if you want, you can check out the free trial and you'll be able to see that yourself. But these are the sources that you can look at. Now, let's look at this thought process. So retaker should start from a weak section. Now, each section should be approached differently. In verbal, you should go module-wise. You should look at SC, CR, RC individually. You need to work on them individually to improve your approach. And in views like word problems or geometry or algebra, go topic-wise in quant. Topics basically mean prime numbers, circles, functions, etc. So focus on one topic at a time in quant. So let's start with verbal first. So how do you improve your verbal score? So first thing is to set a baseline. if you have already taken the GMAT, if you have an ESR with you, if you have the data with you, which was the case with Akshat and Shreyas, that is reliable enough. You don't need to take another baseline test. But in case you don't have that, you should take a baseline test where you take about 30 questions from each area of SC, CR, and RC, and then classify them in two buckets, basically. Group 1 is where your score is less than 70 percentile, and group 2 is where your score is more than 70 percentile. So group 1 is your weak area. Let's take an example. So let's say you take the test and you see that 80, 30, and 50 is your score, respectively. So 80, obviously, SC is your strong area, and CR and RC are your weak areas. And this was basically something which was the case with Akshat also, which I am basically talking about here. So he took CR as his first priority, that he will work on CR skills first. Only when he improves his CR and builds the confidence level in CR, then he moves to RC. And only then he will move to SC later on to fine-tune it further. That was his main idea. So how do you tackle topics from your weak area? So in order to tackle topics from a weak area, let's say CR is one of your weak areas. So from that same sectional test, if you have not taken one, then you have to take one. But if you have taken a sectional test of 20, 30 questions, identify in which concepts are your scores less than 60%. In which topics is your performance poor? For example, let's say if your performance is poor in strengthen related topics, focused on strengthen and all, then you need to work a little on the topic of strengthen. So that is going to be your weak area. Okay. So in that case, what you do is you revise the concept properly first to make sure that you have a sound understanding of the concept. That gap in your thought process, please make sure that you kind of evaluate that concept properly first before practicing questions on that particular area. So this is more like a low hanging fruit that you need to work on, but this is not just enough. After this, you need to also focus on learning application of concepts, okay? And let me talk about that now. How do you learn application of concepts? So first thing in order to do learn application of concepts is you need to learn the right approach. You need to know the right approach. And there are multiple steps involved. For example, I'm just showing you steps for CR and steps for SC, okay? So you need to go through this methodical approach. Even in quant, for example, you always follow a methodical approach. If you are given a question to solve, you'll think about it in a structured fashion. So same thing you should do over here. And to learn the methodical approach, you need to understand the method and then solve 15 questions one at a time. Take only one question at a time. And right after solving the question, review the explanation properly, line by line. Do not just, and reviewing the explanation doesn't mean that you just look at the option choice analysis and move forward. Review it for every question, even the question that you've gotten correct, and match your line of reasoning line by line with the solution to see if there is any deviation whatsoever between how you approached it and how it should have been approached. So make sure you do that, okay? And one big problem, again, this is something which I faced. Many of you might be thinking that, okay, Piyush, you're saying that you should refer to the solutions, but how do I get access to those solutions? In fact, this is one very common question which I also faced as a student, because most of the questions or solutions that I referred to mostly had the problem that they did not focus on the analysis of the question step. The only thing which was provided was why each option choice is incorrect, and which was not really helping me to understand whether I understood the question stem properly or not. And this is a common problem where most resources do not give you that methodical solution. So at GMAT Race, we wanted to solve this problem. And this is one of the biggest reasons why our students have improved by an average of 100 plus points. Okay, we make sure that every solution follows a methodical step-by-step approach. And we do that by spending twice the time in writing the solutions. In fact, we have this concept booster files which are actually dedicated to teach you exactly this methodology itself. So what we do in the concept booster is we give you one question to solve, which is followed by a detailed solution of every single step properly. And what you're supposed to do is analyze the solutions to figure out the gaps. So imagine you solve question number one. You look at the solution one right away after this. You're able to see that, okay, when I was solving the question, I did not follow step two properly. From the solution, you're able to map that. Then you can apply that lesson on question two and see with the solution two that did you apply step two properly? If you did not, you can still do that on question three and so on. So this step-by-step process helps you to improve your understanding of the method properly. Okay. And each question in the concept booster is going to be handpicked. We will prepare you not just for the easiest questions, we will even prepare you for the most difficult questions that can come on the GMAT for that particular topic. In fact, in every topic, this is just a snapshot of our course, you will be able to see that there are concepts that we teach you through videos. Then there is this concept booster where you teach you the method or the process of applying the questions. And then there are quizzes also. This is, by the way, anyway, a quiz, but you have more quizzes as well, and there could be more files which are added. Okay, so this is how you learn the concepts, the approach. Falak, I'm going to take your question. Don't worry. And Sai, I'm definitely going to take that up. Don't worry. So how do you master the application of concepts? So once you have learned the application, like through the concept boosters, then you should practice 30-40 questions in sets of 10. Okay, over here, your focus is to improve your timing. Right now, like when you're learning the concept application, you should not focus on timing. You should focus on making sure that your method is neat. Because understand it this way, guys, if you're taking extra time to solve question, it is most likely because you're not following the right method. You're not following the right steps. Okay, you cannot just cut down on timing by thinking about cutting down on timing. You have to follow the right method first. So please make sure that you focus on application of concepts, learning that properly first, and then you focus on timing part. Now, when you come to this, what you should do is, let's say at this stage, you're taking 2 minutes 30 seconds for each CR question. Okay, let's assume that. Then what you should do is, in the set 1 of 10 questions that you are taking, time yourself at 2:30 only. Do not reduce the time. In the second set, on the other hand, of 10 questions, when you come to this time, you reduce it to 2 minutes 20 seconds. Then in the third set of 10 questions, you reduce it gradually to 2 minutes 10 seconds, and so on. So basically, it is all about making sure that you're comfortable with this timing and gradually reducing the timing, not reducing it in one move. And even at this stage, it is very critical that when you are doing this entire process, you will internalize the process to reduce the time, but you should review the solutions even now. Do not just try to solve more questions. That's a very wrong thing to do. Focus more on learning from each question properly. Okay, so this is how you should work on the verbal section. Now let's talk about the quant part also, but I'll take up the question from Falak. Falak says, I took the exam twice, scored less than lower than mocks in both attempts. Should I try taking the online exam at home? My mocks are always 700 plus, but scored a 670 on the actual test. So Falak, what you're saying is very common. Generally, it can happen because of multiple reasons. It can happen because of the difference of difficulty level in the test. It can also happen because of lack of consistency in the methodology being used. It can also happen because of anxiety on the day of the test. It can also happen because of, let's say, not consistent performance in medium questions and so on. So I need to definitely exactly understand what your pain point is in order to guide you. I would not randomly say that you should do an online exam at home and that will improve your score. I have seen many people doing that. Trust me, in 90% of the cases, if your score on two attempts back-to-back is poor, that indicates some major weaknesses that exist. So I will not recommend taking the test at home right away. First, work on your weak areas, and that will help you to understand that. In case you want to work with us, we want to help you understand how can you work on the GMAT and improve your score, you can definitely connect with us using this link. Okay, so that is there in the chat just above your comment. Okay, what is the total number of questions for each quant and verbal? I think Chandan's question was about GMAT quiz. So again, if you look at our course, there is a lot of detail which is available on our website. You can check it out directly from the website itself. But in general, we have a lot of questions to practice, about 4,000 plus questions which are there on our website, which are available. So you can check that out to like understand Chandan about our course. In the meantime, I'll just move forward with this. So overall, like 4,000 plus questions are there, and a good number of quant and verbal questions are also there. And they are divided against your different type of like sections. In the course, there are like around 1,300 plus questions on quant and verbal. In the quizzing platform, there are 1,300 plus questions, and there are many, many more questions in the mocks and GMAT club test that you get access as a part of it. Thunderbird, again, I'll take your question later. Every course has their own pros and cons. But in simple terms, what you need to do is like check out the free trial of all the courses, but I'll take up your question in the Q&A part. In the interest of time, this is more important. So let's talk about improving your quant score, guys. Okay, how do you improve your quant score? So first thing you need to do is identify your areas of improvement by taking a baseline test in all the four topics. Okay, so and then in the four topics, look at in which areas your score is less than 60%. In the areas where your score is less than 60%, then you have conceptual gaps in those. If your score is between 60 to 85%, then you have application gaps in those. You need to work on the application on that part. Okay. So this is how you identify the root cause. Now, if you have concept gaps in something, the steps on working on that is learn the concepts and formulas on that, then learn how to solve the questions, and then practice 15 to 20 questions. So this is how you approach things in a data-driven format. Okay. If you have application gaps in something, then you don't need to learn the concepts again. Learn how to solve the questions methodically. And you can do this from the concept boosters on GMAT quiz. And then practice about 10 to 15 questions on that particular topic. Okay. Now, if again, I'm just showing you the core weakness analysis engine of GMAT quiz. If you are using GMAT quiz, this is something which will happen. And one person, Thunderbird, you are asking about the difference between one of other popular courses and GMAT quiz. This is one difference which I'm showing you. If anyone else can provide this feature, please do not take GMAT quiz. GMAT quiz is the only course which uses AI to the best degree possible to what I'm showing you now. It has the capability to actually analyze your performance in real time based on your data. Again, most people will just give you data, but here we will actually analyze the data and classify your errors into areas where you have concept gaps, where you have practice gaps, where you have timing gaps. And the best part is you don't just see this data. You can click on revise button and it will actually create a small improvement module for you on the fly, which will take out the relevant videos that you need to watch to improve your conceptual understanding on the same topics that you see. And the best part is after this, you can click on solidify concept and even create a quiz on it. And the time for the quizzes also which are created will basically be tailored towards the weak area. So you can see over here, we are actually telling you to use 28 minutes for the 10 questions. But in the areas where you have fine-tuning to concepts, we are recommending 20 minutes for 10 questions because your conceptual knowledge is fine. So all this is basically automated in the session as well. Okay. So in order to improve your score, basically in the quant section, you need to then arrange these topics in this order. So basically, let's say you have the concept gaps. Okay. So let's say you have concept gaps in this topic. And let's say this topic is also concept gaps. And these topics are basically application gaps. So what you do is you should go through the topics in this order. If you do not have any gaps in topic one, don't do it. If you have concept gaps here, you should work on fractions and decimals. Do everything which is there for fractions and decimals. Go through the videos, go through the concepts, then practice questions and so on. Learn the methods and so on. And for the third one, if you don't have any gaps, leave it. And so on. That is how you should follow it. So you should work on the various errors in this fashion itself. Okay. So this is how you should focus on that part. All right. And as you can see, I've mixed up the topics on number properties, algebra, word problems, and geometry. You should not go. Sorry for this guy's having a little bit of cough. Just give me 1 second. I'm going to get a glass of water and then I'll be able to speak better. Just give me one, like 10 seconds, guys. All right, so what I'm trying to say here is do not go just module wise that, okay, do number properties only or algebra only or word problems only. First, go in this order because this order takes into account the various interdependencies that exist between individual topics. For example, if you are doing prime numbers, before doing prime numbers, you should be really good at exponents because prime numbers will require your understanding of exponents also. Similarly, it will also require you to be good at even odd numbers and so on. So if you go in this order, you're working on more basic concepts first and then working on the more difficult ones. Okay. So this is how you should arrange the topics in the right order. So this is how you can improve your scores. This is just an overview of how you can improve your scores. In case you want to connect with me, you can always connect with me on piyush@gmatquiz.com. The link to schedule a call is going to be there in the comments or the description as well of this video. You can also connect with me on WhatsApp on this number. In case you have any other questions that you would want to ask me now, you can go ahead and ask me. And that will give you a very good idea about the, that will be able to give you a very good idea about your questions overall. Okay, so if you have any questions, feel free to ask me. I'm also sharing a link to schedule a call with me in case you want to. Okay, so let me take up the questions from the chat now. Are there any specific sectional tests that we should take to identify the weak areas? So, Richa, you can take sectional tests from GMAT Club also. They are pretty good, especially for quant. I really like them. And you can take sectional tests from GMAT Viz website as well, like if you're a GMAT Viz student. Manhattan Veritas are also pretty good resources for sectional tests. Okay. Bishop has a question. Is this a strategy session or a sales pitch? And I kind of get this question many times, sometimes basically from students. So trust me, like I have focused, if you were there in the webinar from the very beginning, you would have seen that I have talked a lot about the entire strategy. And as a part of the strategy, if I feel that my course can help you get there, why not? I have just tried to make sure that I close the loop. I just don't want to give you random ideas that, okay, this is how you should improve your score. I want to also tell you how you can do that. And why am I doing this? Simply because I've struggled as a student myself to improve, and I did not find that level of quality or detail in any course which is out there. So if I feel that basically my course can help you, I will be more than happy to tell that to you. And this is a result which we have delivered. You can look at GMAT Club and go and see the score improvement that we have delivered today. So it's up to you at the end of the day. I'm not pushing it to you, Bishop, at all. How to deal with test day anxiety? Okay, so Sharans, to deal with test day anxiety, two things. Number one, do not study a lot before the day of the test. I recommend relaxing like 1 or 2 days before the test. Second, try doing meditation if possible. Third, make sure that your score in mocks are very consistent overall. If your scores are consistent, you are more confident, and then you do not have the anxiety. Thank you, Pooja. Happy to know that the webinar was helpful. Thunderbird, you are asking about the difference between my course and EGMAT, for example. See, again, I'm not supposed to, let's say, tell the differences between our or theirs. Overall, there are many differences which are there. You can check out our website. We actually use personalized study plans and a lot of other things which some other competitors may not be using. So please, my simple recommendation is check out the free trial of both the products that you're like looking at, two or three, whichever products you're looking at. Check out the free trial properly, and the free trial will tell you yourself. Because see, my job is to actually tell you good things about my product. Someone else will tell good things about their product. Don't buy anyone's word. Listen to that, but don't buy anyone's word. Check out the product, because the product will never lie. The product will be always on the face. And we are very confident that if you look at our product, you'll actually fall in love with it, with the level of AI that we have built into it, the level of detail which is there in each and every module. It's a very application focused course, and it is the right amount of course that you have to go through. We have not gotten into too much of detail unnecessarily to create a course which is very lengthy. Our course is concise, to the point, which helps you to get to your outcome faster, and then it uses AI on top of it to even speed up if you are good in certain areas. I hope that answers your question, Thunderbird. Let me take up Shubham's question. How to avoid inflated scores? I used almost all GMAT preps like Veritas, Manhattan, and official GMAX. Shubham, you are in a tough place for sure. Now you have very little mocks left. So my recommendation first is to work on identification of your core problems and then take mocks here. If you're ready, you have worked on your weak areas already, and you're very confident that you can actually push your score up, then take up mocks of GMAT Viz. They are really good. You will be able to identify what your weaknesses are. Even EGMAT mocks are decent in that extent, so you can use that, but they generally don't sell their mocks separately. I'm not sure if they do now, but earlier they did not used to. So, but first thing you have to focus on is improving your understanding. Otherwise, you will end up wasting these mocks also. Can we get a PDF of the slides you presented today? Sunendu, I have not created a PDF as of now. You can write to basically me directly if you want to. I can share the PDF later on. Chandan has a question. Just checking to do we have enough time to get done with the exam before R2 with the course material of GMAT? Yes, Chandan, you definitely have a lot of time. In fact, last year, many students actually started using our course even in October or November, and they were able to improve their scores before round two, because simply because our course is an AI-driven course, very personalized course, and it gives you what you need to work on. So if you need to work on everything, it gives you everything. If you do not need to work on everything, it focuses on the exact things that you need to work on. And you get a very detailed study plan as well to start with. What percentage of overall score is available for free trial? I think, Richa, you meant what percentage of overall course is available for free trial. So in GMAT, there's about 10% of the overall course is available for free trial. You can check it out and take the decision. Okay. Thank you, Thunderbird. I'm happy to know that you're able to understand this. Any other questions, guys? I hope the webinar was helpful. It helped you understand how to improve your score, how to identify your core weak areas. If you have any questions, feel free to ask me. Now I'm going to be here for another 1 minute, maybe. So in case you have any questions, feel free to ask me. In case you want to check out our course for free, you can use this overall. Bishop, I have a 740 on the GMAT with a quant 50 and a verbal 41. Okay. So I hope this webinar was helpful. I don't see any other questions. Do give it a thumbs up if you found this helpful. I tried my best to come up with many new things today, and I hope that was really helpful for all of you. So I wish you all the best. I definitely wish you all the best for the GMAT. Do feel free to connect with me. I have helped many people, and I can definitely help you improve your score. So all the best for your GMAT, and very good night to people who are in India, and good morning to people who are in your US. All the best, guys. Thank you. Thank you so much, Shubham and Zindu.